Hello, everybody, and welcome to Amateur Poker Hour. I'm Luke, taking you through my journey from $100 to $10,000 on online no limit hold'em. No fluff here. Just a channel to kind of share tips and tricks and collaborate with people who are learning and passionate about the game. And today I'm going to be showing you highlights from my $300-something win. And it's a milestone, too, because it's the biggest buy-in I've ever won a tournament for. And now my account's up to, like, something like $900. So, that is over quite a while. So it's been ups and downs, but it's starting to get higher than it's been. So, making some progress. So I'll take you right through the hands. Let me just switch screens here. Alright, here we go. Started with A6 in the cutoff seat. Folds around, raise it up. Gotta love those suited aces. Two callers. Let's get this this thing out of the way here. Alright, so don't get any cards. But I'm pretty sure I'm going to go for the C bet. Yep, always. Yep, and I get folds. Okay, so pretty not too eventful on that one. I picked the hands with the most blinds won. But I guess that's because two people called me. But most hands won't be that boring, promise. 8-king suited. Very early position raises me. Why do I have to keep moving this thing? Okay, very early position raises me. And they've got queen 10 off. Very interesting to call with very few chips from really early position. But anyway, with the 8-king. Oh, I get one caller. I basically have two limpers. And with the 8-king suited, I'm doing a squeeze play bluff. This guy jams. I'm thinking at this point, I got to call, what, like another 6 or 7 to win something like, oh, it gives me my pot odds here, actually. It's 2.31 to 1, 30.2%. So definitely a no-brainer. And I'm actually already ahead here because this guy's got so few chips. I mean, if he had a lot more chips, then it'd probably be tougher for me to call this. But got lucky there. Oh, no, he took it down. Oh, look at that 10 on the river. All right, let's see. Queen-king offsuit. Little min raise. This guy's got twos. Oh, I think I can lock the HUD settings here. Lock layout. Because it's always getting in the way. I hit a queen. I check it because it's three hearts. I really don't want to try to c-bet and get jammed on or something with somebody who's got a decent heart. But then I hit trips. And so I decide to, oh, I still check, actually. I don't want to see the heart come, but now my hand is quite good. So I think I'll definitely bet this one here for value. Did I check it only? Oh, that's weird. I think I would have bet for value if I was really thinking. So probably didn't like the three hearts there, but I think that was a mistake. All right, let's see here. Ace queen from early. Two callers. This HUD is kind of in the way, but I think we'll keep going. 7-jack-2. Maybe I can reset HUD positions. Bear with me for 2 more seconds. Unlock layout. Lock and save layout. Alright, let's try that. It flops. I'll probably do a C bet. Yeah, third pot. This third pot bet is making me a lot of money. I decided to keep going for the bluffy. Yeah, it worked. I went for the double barrel. A lot of low cards. I think those low cards are not really hitting his range very well. So I'm kind of repping a high pair or a jack. Alright. 10-8 offsuit. Oh, I finally fixed the HUD. That's a good thing. guy's got jacks. And I decided to defend for the three big blinds. I hit a gut shot. Oh, the jack is poison for him. I think that's what happened. He bets. Weird. I stayed along for the ride. Normally I would fold this. I don't usually chase gut shots, but I also was thinking I might do, I might take this opportunity to lead out on the turn. So there's this one trick that I shared in a previous video where when there's a lot of low cards like this and they could connect, actually they can't really connect too well. They can't turn into straights too well. An 8, 10, or jack turns into a sort of a higher straight. But yeah, if it came at a 7 or 8, it actually could straighten. But anyway, I decided to stay along. And yeah, I'm going to lead and kind of take the initiative here. If it comes something like a 4 or a 9 or probably a 7 or probably an 8 or a 10, because 8s and 10s start to straighten. 8s and 10s improve my hand. So that was kind of what I was thinking if it comes something low like that. Anyway, I hit the absolute best possible card, the absolute poison card. I can't even believe that happened. That's a beauty. He bets. I don't think anyone can really catch up to me at this point. I mean, obviously, in the unluckiest situation, the 10 king or something pairs, then I'm not loving it. But I decided to just play it slow like this and just call. And sure enough, I got to do something on the river. I don't want to just let it go check. So I do a tiny bet. The reason why I bet so small with these four big blinds is I want to tempt him to jam. I'm kind of like teasing him like, I'm going to steal this pot. And if he's got nothing, maybe he'll consider just going over the top and jamming on me. Anyway, he raises. So he thinks he's milking me. And it was just a perfect situation. So lucky hand. Let's see here. What else we got? A7 offsuit. Min raise. Definitely min raise with the A7 and the cutoff like that. Alright, I've got a gut shot. I'm definitely going to c-bet this. And just took it. Alright. So those hands are not too interesting. Next time I'll filter out the hands that are just like 4 or 5 big blinds one. All the other hands are probably going to be much bigger. Alright, pretty early position and I min raise with the 8-9 suited. You gotta love those Dan Negreanu suited connectors. So I'm gonna c-bet this, get a caller, and now I turn the spade. So I think I'll continue here with a half pot probably. This is what I normally do. I don't know if it's right, but took it down. So a lot of fold equity. Maybe you'll hit your spade. Look at that. I'm just kind of limping with this guy. Yeah, I read a book that said like limpers breed limpers, but I actually do like to limp sometimes with my early position, weak suited aces, just to see if I can just kind of see a flop for decently cheap. In this case, it's definitely going to be decently cheap, so I'm going to come along for the ride. And sure enough, I hit the top pair. I think I'm going to check this. I don't normally bet into like just a top pair ace like that. I'll often just check call. This guy's betting, definitely going to just call this. And here, I'm actually going to move this one out of the way to unlock. So it comes a 5. It's not great or bad. The 5 was a pretty good card, I guess. But I think I'm just going to check it. Oh no, I'm going for value here. Yeah, actually, yeah, probably go for value. I don't know. I don't know what the right answer is there, but decided to give him a chance to dunk off a few more chips. All right, let's see. Get to see the flop for free. I've got a gut shot. Need a 6. And I decided to call. I think this is another case where I'm tempted to pull a bluffy lead on the turn. And this is the perfect time to lead on the turn. Because you could hit that straight with that 2, or you can now hit like some really bad low pair with your 2. But he bets it. Oh, I can't lead because I'm in position. But sure enough, I go for the raise. The bluffy raise, and sure enough, yeah, those low cards, like when you're just passive until the turn and then you bet, those low cards can be good opportunities, I think, for steals. Alright, six jack of diamonds. This will be a no-brainer defend. Sure enough, I hit two pair. This guy's got 14 big blinds. So right now all I'm thinking is, what does it take for me? So I've got 9.59 big blinds. What does it take for me to get all his money in the pot? And I don't feel too at risk here with the top two pair. So I just check it. He bets. I waited for a long time, I remember, and just like pretended like I was thinking about it. Check the turn again. He checks. I think I'm gonna have to go for something. I bet you I'll put like four big blinds or something. Yeah. So five big blinds and just tempt him to call with something like a seven, even maybe a six. And he just folds, no worries. Let's see. Ace queen. I've got 14 big blinds. Oh, this guy from under the gun is all in. I'm kind of thinking here that I want somebody to re-raise jam on me. Oh, nope. Maybe not. Just want to take the pot down. That works. And let's see if I get lucky here. Sure enough. All right. I think maybe this is where the tournament's starting to get later in the game because there's less players at this table. So I've only got eight big blinds left. And I just jam with the queen nine. Yep. I'm getting desperate at this point. Sure enough, he calls me. And this guy calls me. Well, you gotta get a little lucky sometimes if you're gonna win a tournament. In this case, oh, this guy's trying to bluff at it. Oh, he goes all in with the bluff. This guy's definitely gonna fold. How does he call that? Just with the ace high. Wow. And then amazingly, I hit my queen. So here I triple up, and it's setting me up in a good position to, yeah, so now there's like five players left, I believe. Jack King, min raise. Guy calls, two over cards, definitely gonna see bet. Oh, I just checked it. I think at this point I'm thinking about payout spots. I don't think this is the final table, actually. I think it's getting to like the last couple tables, last few tables, and I'm thinking I don't wanna like spend much money right now. I wanna coast. And if I can check it to the river, I'll check it. Maybe I'm just gonna let go of this. Oh, I pull a huge bluff here. Interesting. Well, since I was passive on the flop, everything is low cards. You know what? Some of these situations I'm experimenting with, I really have no idea why I check raise there. Oh, and then he raises me. Well, that was an expensive move. Frankly, I don't know if that was the right decision right there. Okay, I've got ace king. Good timing because I am starting to get on fumes. 10 big blinds. This guy's definitely going to call me with the queen king. I'm just praying for no queen here. Sure enough, got to double up. Pretty sweet moment there, so I can keep surviving. All right, ace queen. I've got 17 big blinds. This guy raises it. I think here I'm actually gonna jam on him. I think we want him to call me with some weaker ace. Oh no, I just re-raised. Interesting, and he calls me. Nine jack. I hit the ace. At this point, I've got basically the size of the pot left. And I bet a little bit. Come to think of it, I think I should have jammed there because there's a flush coming. He could definitely possibly have a weaker ace and think that I'm bluffing and call it off. But he re-raises me and I just go all in. And I'm hoping for no club. I think the odds of the club was like something like 30 something percent. So if I'm going in there with the top pair, I'm definitely loving that situation. In general, as I understand it, this is my mental model here. Any hand where your odds are better than 50%, these are the situations. That's how you measure. That's the measuring stick. Like, if you think, and you have to think about pot odds as well, but if you think that in the long run, if I ran this hand 1,000 times and I'd more often than not make some money, That's the measuring stick. And you might be thinking, well, I should have better odds than that. Like, I don't want to just flip a coin 1,000 times and have to win 1,000 times to get to the end of the tournament. But it doesn't really equate like that, because you're not usually all in for all your money. And I think that's the measuring stick you want. Am I going to win money more often than not with this move? So anyway, I bet this top pair here. I've got the top pair now. It comes three spades. I'm thinking, well, there's only one spade better than me. I really like the position that I'm in. I check it. Yeah, I'm thinking I'm wanting this guy to bluff. And sure enough, he jams all in. And I'm thinking, oh, he's definitely got the ace of spades. But I've already got the top pair. It's unlikely that he's got the flush already. And it's possible that he's just going after his 10 of spades or something like that. So I decided to call it, and sure enough, the spade didn't come, but I already had the top pair. So that was a critical moment of the entire tournament. Queen king, raising it up. Guy jams on me. I'm definitely gonna call here for 12 big blinds. He's ahead, but and takes it. Yep. Alrighty. Can't win them all. Force. I re-raise this guy here. Yeah. This is an interesting situation. It's either, I think it's getting close to, I think this is the final table at this point. And I'm basically the big stack here. Yeah. I'm the big stack here, so I want to bully a little bit. And I've already got a pair. I'm thinking maybe I can re-raise. This guy's basically in the cutoff seat, so he could easily have like 9-10 suited, or ace two offsuit even. I could see him raising the min raise with. So if he gets three bet here, he's gonna fold a ton. And this, let's just check his stats, because I think I was looking at his stats. Capra Banga. Oh, I don't see his stats here, so I don't know what happened with my HUD. I think I could have seen them before. But anyway. Oh, he jams. Well, I'm definitely gonna fold the force. I don't wanna risk my whole tournament. All right, pocket tens. This guy calls. Not loving the high cards on the flop. He checks it. I'm still gonna c bet just because I was the leader. So, and then incredibly, I hit the trips. It's a absolutely beautiful time to make a hand. Go for a half pot. Guy folds. I really like didn't wanna. Let's go back for a second. I really didn't want to. There's a lot of stuff that can straighten here, right? Like, if a jack comes or a king comes, I'm really not liking that situation of having trips. Like, it's really easy to have a straight if a jack or a king comes. If another, I don't know, if a pair comes, I'm loving it. But there's the other thing too of just like, actually no, I think I was just trying to protect against the straight, and rather win a little than lose a lot. So, and especially near the end of the tournament. Four players left. Ace four. This guy's got ace 10. I decided to call it off. People with 14 big blinds, they can definitely be pulling some sneaky stuff here. I think a lot of people are gonna like their jack queen suiteds and things like that. The more I think about it, though, 14 big blinds might be a little tough for me to call this. So I question my decision right now, calling 14 bigs. I think probably 10 is a no-brainer call. 14, though, that's a pretty significant size of my stack, so I'm on the fence about this move. But in the end, I actually, did I get it? Yes, I hit the four. Got lucky there. All right, three players left. Guys, calling. And I hit the top pair. So I do a half pot c bet, and this guy jams on me. So what are his stats? I've seen 135 hands on this guy. He's playing 38% of hands, which is a lot. And he's raising 20% of hands. I think these stats are very aggressive. He's got a 48% steal. Only folds to the steal like half the time. He's got a high 3-bet. Every single time he continuation bets. Oh, it's only 4 out of 4 times. But anyway, this guy's aggressive. That's my point. I was really tempted to call him here, but I thought, you know what? 3 players left. I'm calling off like 21 big blinds. I decided to live to fight another day. I didn't know if he hit some kind of trips or an ace jack. You might call me tight, but I won the tournament, so you can cry about it after. All right, queens. I jam. Oh, yeah, so now it's the final two. And since I saw him, like, being very aggressive, and also this is my thought process here. We finally battle and we get to the very end of the tournament. Well, some people at that point, especially when they're ahead, because he's the big stack here, he's got 9 more big blinds than me, they're thinking, well, I've gone this far. All I have to do is get lucky one more time. I've seen people do that. In fact, Daniel Negreanu took a losing coin flip when he was winning his first World Series of Poker. He had the ace high flush draw, but he didn't have anything else, and he just called all in. And he got lucky and hit, but I just found that really interesting because he was behind. He might have had the edge overall to people who'd be jamming. But anyway, the mentality is you're getting to the end. Your kids might be nagging you. I wanted to give this guy an opportunity to just dunk off all his chips. I mean, normally you want to milk the queens, but I said to myself, you know what? Let's see if he's interested in, you know, doing a little tango here. Most of the time, you know, if he wasn't so aggressive before, I wouldn't have given him this opportunity. But sure enough, he decides to come with a 10-6. I have no idea what he's doing. He's probably got to go to dinner or something. But anyway, that was where everything changed in this final heads up. And then he started to get crazy aggressive on me. Like, he was just betting everything. And it was just weird because, like, he's the short stack, but I wasn't really hitting. I was definitely kind of like going through many hands with like nothing. Here he calls. I hit my jack. But yeah, I was doing a lot of folding. And like he actually evened the scales a little bit there. I call with the jack. He's got a jack 4. Oh, he's got the flush here. Yep. So he was battling back and super aggressive. But to combat him, I decided to just lay low, like do a lot of just flat calling before the flop and just let hands go. Because if he really wants to be a maniac, 2, 3, 4, 5. So he's got an open ended and I've got a 5. And see, here's the situation, right? Even on the turn, he's betting half pot. I just call with my 5 and again, he checks the river. So like he's betting twice with nothing, right? And on the turn he hit a gut shot, but like that's kind of how he was playing, is he was betting everything. So I was just waiting for an opportunity to kind of hit some pair or whatever. He bets pre-flop. I just flat call here. I think I just flatted. Yeah, I've got 8-9 suited. Normally I'd raise with that. I mean, heads up, I would totally raise with that, but I don't want him to go nuts on me. And sure enough, I hit a 9, and as soon as I hit that 9, I'm thinking he might want to donk off his chips again. So I decided to put them all in. Sure enough, he calls with 2 overs and doesn't hit. And that's all she wrote. So, pretty exciting tournament. So that got me up to, let's check the stats. So this is 888 poker. 888 poker that I'm in right now, right? So yeah, I'm at 888. These are the ones that I always buy in. Like between like, I don't know, $2 and $16 at this point is the level that I go. I do about 5 or 8 tournaments at once. And it's been a lot of fun so far, and hopefully I'm starting to turn the corner where my account's starting to climb. Let's see what my stats were today. Let's go to, this is the last thing I'll show you, and then we'll be done. Tournaments by day is how I like to look at it, because today I bought into 8 tournaments and I got in the money in 2 of them, almost 3, and I won one. And anyway, my all-in adjusted big blind per 100 is 8.47, and I hear it, if it's more than 7, you've got that level of game beat. And so that's why I'm starting to venture up to like from like the $10 buy-ins to the $16 buy-ins. So you can see some days I'm like averaging 100 big blinds per per 100 hands. That's abnormally high, but usually I'm positive. So it's a nice way to be able to look at your stats. This is Hold'em Manager 3. Highly recommend it. $100 gets you a license for a year. A lot of cool stats there, and that's how I'm showing all my hands. Anyway, hope you guys enjoyed the video. And feel free to like and subscribe. I'll definitely keep on fighting and studying and trying to build this up, and I'm gonna get to 10,000. So hopefully you hang with me along the journey, and hope maybe we'll all learn something along the way about poker. Take care, guys. See you next time.